Amen. Amen. Welcome. We're very glad to see you all this morning. We're going to share together in some singing now. So would you just stand and sing with us?
Thank you. God's Spirit sent him to die. I scarce can take it. Let on the cross my burden gladly bear it. He bled.
Sing with me, how great.
and age to age, she stands above everything.
Time is in his hands.
Time is in his hands. Beginning and the end. Beginning and the
praise. I'll create you. There's no other name, Lord, in the heaven by which you can be saved. Thank you for the Lord Jesus. Oh, praise you, Lord God, for your wisdom, for your kindness, for your mercy. Thank you, Holy Spirit. You're welcome here, Lord. Oh, manifest yourself here, Lord. Let all know how great you are.
We're so grateful to be in your presence today. We welcome you, Holy Spirit, to have your way in the hearts of each person gathered here. Oh, Holy Spirit, come, minister even now. Bless and touch each person. Che ti ando da embrassia con la barato io ambroto la che broto che amato che io mascianda dal barasso la baracco della dia. Becco la nantia poroto la mianda dal barasia poroco la barato della dia ando della dia so con la barati ando della dia. Praise you, Father God. Praise your mighty name. Thank you, Father God, for granting unto your children salvation and glory and love and peace and life and more abundantly so. Thank you, Father God, for granting unto us these things that the world cannot offer, these things that people seek and they cannot find outside of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father, that you have delivered us into your kingdom, that you have shared your truth with us and caused it to be known in our hearts, that we might receive from you these good gifts that you have. Oh, Father, I pray for those lost in the world, those dying in corruption and sin, those who are seeking a way out, that, Father, today you would loose your spirit upon them, that the spirit of revival would go forth, that you would bring people to their knees under conviction as your Holy Spirit ministers to them, and as you reveal the truth that Jesus Christ was buried and has arisen and is Savior of all the world. Oh, Father God, I pray that today you would set the captives free and that everything the devil is sought to do would come to nothing. It would fall to the ground and shatter in Jesus' name. Oh, Father, I thank you for victory in Christ Jesus. I thank you that the devil hears the name of Jesus and he trembles in fear. I thank you, Father God, that the demons flee at the name of Jesus Christ. I thank you, Father God, that sickness yields in the bodies of your people when they receive the promises of your kingdom. Oh, thank you, Father God, for the name of Jesus. At the name of Jesus, all shall bow. All shall bow the knee and declare that he is Lord. Oh, praise you, Father God. We thank you today for this victory that we have in Jesus' name. Father, I know there are people who are dreadfully fearful of the COVID-19. I know there are people who are dreadfully fearful of Black Lives Matter or the anti-Black Lives Matter, whatever. But Father God, I declare today that you are in charge and that this sickness has no part in your people and that this Political disruption has no part in your people. We are to walk in love and faith and endurance and to see right through all of this stuff that the world is throwing at us. I thank you for victory over these things, and I curse that COVID-19 in Jesus' name. I command it to die in Jesus' name. I speak on behalf of the people who are trapped in their homes, fearful. I pray, Lord, that you would lift them up, that you would raise up within them a banner of Christ, that they would know that they are yours and that they've been washed by the blood and that they have nothing to fear. I say nothing to fear, for if you are with them, who can be against them? Oh, thank you, Father, for victory this day in Jesus' mighty name. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Praise the mighty name of Jesus. Glory, glory, glory. Oh, we lift high your name, Father God. Oh, mighty God, we thank you for your love and mercy. Thank you, Father God, for your generosity, for your kindness unto us. Oh, Lord, you have revealed yourself through your Son, and we are so grateful, Father God. Bless the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Praise you, Lord God. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. Morning, good morning, good morning. It's nice and cool in here.
Hallelujah!
Ooh, all right. It's good to have everyone here. It's good to see you. Welcome, welcome. Good to see you too, Anthony, and you brought a friend with you. Yeah. Welcome, sir. Gary, welcome. Just going to commit this to the Lord. Heavenly Father, thank you for your life. Thank you, it's true. You have called us out of the kingdom of darkness and into your kingdom. Thank you that there's a new scene. There's an out to the world system. And we just receive, Lord, your presence and your speaking, Lord. And I thank you so much for your body and your presence here. In Jesus' name, amen. I see we have Becky and me sharing here. I may call Becky up here at some point, depending on how the Lord guides with it. But what I'm going to share today are just some things that the Lord has put on my heart that he's been teaching me over like the past 2 or 3 months, definitely over this season. And he took me here to this passage in Matthew 7 and had me go over it and started digging up some things inside of me. So there may be some vulnerable things that I share here this morning too, just as I'm speaking from what like the Lord is showing me and teaching me as well. And it might be really short, but anyway, one thing that the Lord brought to mind the other day is, you all know John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, right? Now, the same writer, John, wrote in another section in 1 John chapter 2, verse 15, He said, love not the, neither the things that are. Okay, how can the same writer say that? What is the Holy Spirit saying? He's God loved the world, and yet he's saying in another section, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. For he that loveth the world, the love of the Father is not in him. And as the Lord's been teaching me more of this, I started to understand what that meant. And that is that God doesn't love the system, but he loves the people. Do you hear that? And so here's one of the things. The world is stuck in a system of thought. He brings it out there, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, the boastful pride of life. And there's somewhat of a system that the world is caught in. And really, the only way out is for God to bring you into the kingdom. Like, that's the real only hope for the world. I mean, yes, there's things that we can change here and there. But, like, Jesus is really the only peace that you can have in the midst of something like this. Or what? He's the way out. He's the answer. I think that's being emphasized more and more. And praise God that he does shake the system so that the things that cannot be shaken would shine forth, so that people would grow up to, oh, I need to put my hope in God, not in, you know, what I thought I should be resting my life on. And praise God that he does that. So let's turn to Matthew chapter 7. And this is right after a really dear section of scripture that's close to my heart in Matthew chapter 6, where Jesus talks about seeking his kingdom, seeking first his kingdom and his righteousness. And praise God, he gets to be the one that is right. It's his rightness. It's not about me being right. It's about God being right. Actually, the truth is, I'm not right. I'm just going to confess to you, I'm not right. Like, I'm not right. He's right. And rightness is just getting under him. Lord, you're right. You get to be right. Seeking first his kingdom, his righteousness. And in the context of this, he's talking about you can't serve two masters. You can't be looking at two different things. And he continues this thought here in Matthew 7, verse 1. It says, judge not, that you be not judged. For with the judgment you judge, you will be judged. And the measure you use, it will be measured to you in return. It's kind of like, you know, your measuring cup. Whatever measuring cup you use, that's the one that I'm using for myself. In other words, we can't have a measuring cup that we use for other people, and yet we want other people or God to use a different measuring cup with me, right? And that's kind of one of the twisted things of the world, is like, we want everyone to take it easy on me, but I want to be strict when it comes to someone else, right? We're real good at that, okay? And we, you know, we make excuses for ourselves when we do things wrong, but when someone does something wrong to us, we want to, you know, to execute them. We want to judge them. Anyway, and so he says here, the judgment you judge, you will be judged, and the measure you use, it will be measured to you again. Why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye and do not notice the log in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, and behold, the plank or the beam is in your own eye? You hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. One of the things that the Lord opened my eyes to see in this is that often with judging is this. Judging is actually there we go. Yeah, it's taking the place of the. It's in other words, it's not my job to judge you. That's someone. That's his job. Okay. It's a picture is me sitting in the judge's chair. Okay, and here's the difficult thing about this, is that legitimate injustices happen. Legitimate injustices happen to me, and they happen to other people. The question is, how do we deal with it? All right? And if I take vengeance, or if I become the one to... And of course, in the world, when you don't trust that God is your judge, you have to be the judge. Okay? If you don't have God in your life, that's the mentality. And the thing is, though, as believers, we need to recognize that there is a judge, and he's not me. Okay? And I'm glad. And I'm actually glad. He's in the judge's chair. The word judgment, it means to cut or to discern. It's like to weed through evidence and to make a call. It's the, with it is the sense of a condemnation or a decision that's being made. It means that you have authority in the situation, okay? Now, here's the thing. Most of the time, we don't have authority over that person that we're trying to judge. There are certain places in the scripture where you will see judgment happening. For example, there's a passage where Paul says, I'm with you in spirit, and I've decided to judge such a one. You're like, why is he judging? I thought the Bible said, no, Paul's in a position to actually judge because he's been given authority. There's another example where two men are arguing about their inheritance, and they say, Jesus, you know, tell him to give me my share. And Jesus said, who made me judge and arbiter over you? It's a position of authority, okay? So let's not assume authority over one another. If you're in a job or if you're a leader in a church or different things, there's a certain measure of you can make a decision in the situation because it's your call, okay? Because you've been given that authority. But Jesus is speaking here about our brother, okay? Why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye and do not notice the log in your own eye? And one of the pictures I get is, you ever seen little kids do this sometimes? It's kind of like, I'm sorry to bring this up, Mr. Steve, but sometimes when I'm over there with the little kids, there'll be like, one of the kids is like disrupting and making noise. They're like, yeah, yeah, yeah. And the other kid looks over and he's like, shut up, you're making noise! You know, and it's like, what happens, it's a really good picture. It's, I'm jumping out of bounds to get someone else back in line, right? I see someone out of line, but I'm stepping out of line to go get them back in line. Two wrongs don't make a right, see? Or it's not my place to do something about it or to call them out on it, okay? That's a really simple example. Why do you look at the speck in your brother's eye and do not notice the plank in your own eye? One of the truths here, which is really powerful, is that just like in the passage before, I need to be under the authority of my master. Judging has to do with, I need to believe and trust that they have a master and it's not me. Okay? The phrase, that judge not that you be not judged. And here's the thing. They have a judge, and I have a judge, and it's not me, it's someone else. And I need to realize that their judge is also my judge. My judge is their savior, and their savior is my judge. Okay? It's said here, let's turn to this verse. Go to James chapter 4. Verse 11. So in James 4:11, I was reading through this at the beginning of the year, and for some reason I was going over it, but it says here, do not speak against one another, brethren. He who speaks against a brother or judges his brother speaks against the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge of it. There is only one lawgiver and judge, the one who is able to save and to destroy. But who are you who judge your neighbor? Do you see the judge and the savior is Jesus Christ? Okay, he is both Lord, Master, Judge, and Savior. And he is my Savior and my Lord and my Master, but he's also that to other people as well, okay? It's not, who am I? It's not me. I'm not the Master. He's the Master. He's their Master. There's another passage. Let's look up this. Romans chapter 14, verse 1. I'm giving you a chance to look it up. Okay, Romans 14, 1 says, "Now accept the one who is weak in faith, but not for the purpose of passing judgment on his opinions. One man has faith that he may eat all things, but he who is weak eats vegetables only. Let not him who eats regard with contempt him who does not eat, and let him who does not eat judge him who eats, for God has accepted him. Who are you to judge the servant of another? To his own master he stands or falls, and stand he will, for the master is able to make him stand." Do you see his point here? He's like, he doesn't answer to you. He answers to his own Lord. He answers to his own master. And that connects really well with Matthew 6, where it's no man can serve two masters. And we see this, judge not. It's like, you got to be under a master, and you got to recognize that other people are under a master as well, and it's not you. And recognizing that it's not my jurisdiction or responsibility to sit in the judge's chair over someone else's life. Now, here's the thing. They may be absolutely wrong. And that's usually the thing, right? They're just wrong. Like, they're wrong. Now, here's the and here's what we do. So in the next chapter, or in the next verse, what do? We try to fix them. So we go over to try to take the speck out of their eye, or try to, you know, help them get their act together. And I was, you know, the end of this actually is that you are helping your brother, okay? First take the log of your own, then you'll see clearly. But before, the thing is, I have to go to God first. What happens is often I see something wrong in a situation or whatever, and my first reaction is, I need to fix that person, right? Have you ever tried that before? Try to fix somebody? Or, and the Lord knows that, yes, we are there for a reason in the situation, but we have to go about it with him and under his authority. I have to do things under him. And he says, "How can you say to your brother, 'Let me take the speck out of your eye,' when behold, the log is in your own eye?" I need the Lord to work in me, and I need to be under his authority first. And it's, I need to be under his authority in how I even deal with the wrongs of other people around me. Okay? The verse, "You hypocrite," this is an interesting, so hypocrite means under, crit, which is that word for judge. So it's like, hypocrite, the idea is, you're under a judge too now. Don't be saying one thing to this person and you're doing the wrong thing or you're stepping out of bounds. "You hypocrite, first take the log out of your own eye, then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye." And what you see here is that God leads us to the cross, because that's the place where blindness is dealt with and where the things of the Lord need to be dealt with. Injustice happens. It's sad. And God doesn't sit around and say nothing about it. Okay? Judgment does not mean, or not judging does not mean that you say a wrong didn't happen. It's recognizing your role in the situation. Okay? Most of the time, or the world's way, is to react and to become the judge in this situation. It's recognizing, how am I to respond to injustice when someone does me wrong? How am I supposed to acknowledge that it was wrong, but deal with it in a way that the Lord would have me to deal with the situation? Okay? And the only thing I've come to really, it's like the Lord draws you more to, Lord, I need you. I need your, we go from accusing people or, and here's what we do. Here's the subtle lie of judging. An injustice happened, an evil happened, it was wrong. But instead of separating our role, we start accusing the person and condemning the person and hating the person. And there's a step in between that we've missed. We didn't go to the Lord with it. We made agreements with the enemy over things, okay? And I feel like I want to call Becky up to explain a little bit more about this. Love, you want to come and share a little bit? Because the Lord's been showing Becky some of this too, and I'd rather her share it because she's actually got a lot of good insight. I'm learning a lot of stuff from being married to Becky. By the way, today we're celebrating 9 months being married. So,
Ephesians 1. The Lord put this on scripture in my heart this morning that is like, whoa, good job, Tim. Like, the Lord's in this because he set this up really well for us to go right here. Verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. That verse doesn't sound like it connects at all until you know what the word blessing means. It doesn't mean stuff in a treasure chest full of good stuff. It means well speaking. It means to speak well of. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has spoken well of us in heavenly places in Christ. When this clicked for me, like, it was like a whoa moment. And I continue to cry when I like really grasp this. God's up in heaven. Jesus can hear him. The angels can hear him. Satan can hear him. The demons can hear him. And he's speaking well of you. He's speaking well of you. He sees you under the blood. Think of every person in your life, he's speaking well of them too. He's speaking well of the world because of the blood of his son over the world. Do you know what this means if we grab a hold of this for ourselves and for others? Because here's the point with judging. I actually join forces with the accuser of the brethren against someone. Here's how I always pictured a conversation about me went in heaven. God says to Jesus, Jesus, how's Becky? Holy Spirit, how's Becky coming along? They say, well, we're working on her. She's still struggling with this. She has an issue here. She has a failure here. But, you know, we're working on her. Hopefully she'll get it. You know, it's kind of like that, like, and there's accusation, there's condemnation, there's frustration. I picture I'm being accused before the throne room of heaven, when in actuality, that's what the devil is doing over me. I have called what the devil is speaking over my life and over others. That's what I think Jesus is saying to Father about me, and he's not. There's well speaking going on because of the blood of Jesus Christ. When I enter into that over myself, number one, you got to go there for yourself. Like, you have to get alone with the Lord. When you start getting it, like, Lord, you're speaking well of me, all of a sudden, you face a frustration with someone that you don't like very much, and God's like, I'm speaking well of them too. And you're like, no, you're not. You're accusing them just like, you're on my side, right? I'm right, and you're agreeing with me. Lord's like, no, I'm right, and I want you to agree with me, right? I don't care what situation is going on in the world right now. It's not that the media is right. It's not that the Democrats are right. It's not that the Republicans are right. It's not that the president's right and everyone else is wrong. It's that God is right. We are not right. He desires to bring us into his rightness, that the body of Christ would come into line with the Lord. Look away from the media and look to the Lord. Look at the media when he tells you to, but don't unless he tells you to. That's kind of the bigger picture for how the Lord allows these puzzle pieces for me to fit in. But when the Lord started just showing me like a victim mentality, you know, you're like, oh, those poor people, they're just always walking around feeling sorry for themselves, you know? And when the Lord shows you that's you, you're like, oh no, woe is me. Praise the Lord for light. That means he wants to do something about it. Receive light, receive light. Light received always brings more light. Light rejected brings darkness. This was a couple years ago. I had a night where I just couldn't fall asleep. So I like, you know, you're just kind of groggy and wide awake, sleepy. And I was just like, oh, well, I'll fold laundry. The Lord just started speaking to me. And there was all these scenarios where I could see the situation as the Lord saw it versus how I saw it. But different circumstances that were in my life or different people or there was always this like, poor you, isn't that terrible how this happened? Isn't that hard how that person, like, that was so wrong. Like, see, isn't this terrible? Isn't this hard? And what the Lord showed me is like, Becky, in all those things you've been agreeing with the enemy and you haven't been agreeing with me. And like, you know this, when the light comes on and you see yourself for who you are, just like, it's, number one, it's freeing, but then it's also, oh, this is terrible. Better than this. And anyway, I took out my journal and I just started writing all these like little, I didn't realize that they had been agreements made with the enemy. But it's just like, when this person did this, it made me feel this way. And in that moment of vulnerability, Lord, I looked to the enemy and I shook hands with him. And in that moment of vulnerability, I should have looked to you and agreed with you, but I made an agreement with the enemy. I received this, the lies and the feelings, and guess who I pinned all of that emotion on? That person. You did this to me. You made me feel this way. You ruined my life in this way. What I'm doing is I'm agreeing with the accuser of the brethren about that person. And it's a victim mentality. And then I get to walk around being hurt all the time because they did this to me, therefore they need to pay. I get in the judge's chair. What the Lord would have me do in this situation, number one, I actually, even if I was wronged, and it's forgiveness is never calling wrong okay. It's not saying it didn't matter. Forgiveness is actually acknowledging that it was wrong. It's taking it to the right judge. But the way the Lord would have me deal with a victim mentality is I confess where I shook hands with the enemy. And I say, Lord, will you take back this ground that I gave the enemy? And I allowed him to come in and live in this plot of ground. Will you take back that ground by the blood of Christ? And then, Lord, will you come build your own stronghold in this place? And then from that place, it's so cool. You realize why you're in the situation in the first place is to receive the life of the Lord and be a channel for him to that very person or in that very set of circumstances that hurt you. If we don't get that, we'll keep perpetuating the plans of the enemy in a situation, right? But if we come into line with agreement with the Lord, ask him to take back the ground that we gave the enemy, all of a sudden I become a channel to that person. Like, it's so cool. Like, you were meant to house a spirit, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God. But the enemy knows that too, so he tries to use you to house the demonic spirits, right? anyway, I think that's all I had on this.
Oh, that was really good, though. One of the things that Becky shared, which was really good, is I accept lies and then I blame the other person for how I feel or how the situation is working out. And it's like one of those things that's deep down under, you're like, what is going on? And it comes to a point of, I have to first go to my judge and savior. I have to deal with the hurts and the bitternesses that I have in my heart first before I can actually rightly be a channel for the Lord to help someone else who's hurt as well. Because hurting people hurt people, right? And it's learning, like, and you can't go through this life without, you know, without an injustice happening against you, someone doing something, someone whatever. And learning to respond in God's way versus the world's way. And I appreciate you sharing that, love. Thank you. Thank you. So, forgiveness is not saying that what someone did was right. It's releasing it to God. It's releasing it and letting go and saying, Lord, it's not for me to be in the judge's chair. It's not for me to fix that person. I'm giving it to you. I'm trusting you in this situation. And I'm looking to the blood of Jesus to cover this wrong that was done. Lord, if you are willing to die for this sin, then I can't carry it around with me and I can't hold on to it, all right? And it's hard. There's things that happen. There's wrongs that are done, even from a young age in our lives, things that happen, domestic violence, abuse, things that were said, things, you know, God wants to come in and just bring his light and his healing. You know, it's, we're scared sometimes to go there because it's a little bit exposing, but it's healing. Light comes in and replaces, okay, and replaces those areas and brings a release, which is what forgiveness in many ways is, a release of the carrying of it, okay? First take the log out of your eye, then you will see clearly, and this is the end result, and this is so good, is I get to become a channel of God's presence in the situation. Versus before, I was like, either protecting myself or hiding or you know, being the victim or being the judge. It's two sides of the same coin. And now it's learning to, Lord, I receive your desire towards that person. I just offer myself to your love for them or your will towards them, whatever that might be. It's not that I'm not discerning. He goes on later on to say, beware of false prophets. You'll know them by their fruit. So it's not like he's saying, you know, you just pretend everything's okay. No, but you don't have to be the executioner of justice over their lives. You can be under your master in a situation and entrust, they get to answer to their master for them, okay? I know for me personally, I've had my own journey in this and I'm still going through it. And allowing the Lord to expose me, to reveal things in my heart. I remember, it's interesting. Sometimes when light comes, we apply it to everyone else, right? And I remember at times in my life, like, Lord bringing truth and revelation. And I remember, I don't remember this happening, but I'm not dealing with it under the Lord I remember seeing wrongs in other people around me and becoming very critical and judgmental and be like, man, they don't get it. They're not getting it. Like, what's wrong? You know, like, and really struggling with that. I went through a period of that, especially about 10 years ago, where I really wrestled with judging and pointing the finger. And the thing was, I was right. That's the hard part, is like, yeah, like I know it's wrong, you know. And I remember the Lord convicting me of that, and I knew it wasn't right. I remember actually being, it's hard for me to talk about some of these things sometimes, but I remember really struggling with things going on here, even in this church, with leadership and different things that have happened over the past. I remember going back and like, Lord, I forgive so-and-so, I choose to forgive so-and-so, I choose to forgive. And things that were done that were wrong, you know, and giving it to the Lord, giving those things to the Lord. I remember one time, I remember it was like 7 or 8 years ago, I actually came to the elders at the church and like, I just have to confess, I've been bitter against the church, you know, I've been upset, and I just, the Lord's convicted me about that, and I remember them bringing me here, and we prayed, and there was like a real release, giving it up to the Lord, and I remember struggling a little bit too. There was multiple things going on in my life, but on the other side, there's the fear of man, okay? So on one side, you know, you protect yourself in judgment. The other side is the fear of man, and you care too much about what people think and pleasing people in situations that you actually don't even say anything when you should be saying something, you know what I mean? And so learning that side as well, like, oh, Lord, and just God bringing light to me that, you know, I have wrestled with things personally, and the Lord's been dealing with me with that, and choosing to offer myself to God's desire over those around me. Choosing to offer myself to what is God's heart in this situation and what is His view of the people around me. In many ways, that's what the log is. It's in my eye. It's in my perspective. It's in how I look at the people around me. And it taints to how I look at God, because I think God looks at me that way, so I look at other people that way. And the Lord is a good master. You know, now I remember something happened the other day where I got upset or whatever, and I just said, oh, Lord, you know them. You know how to deal with them about that. And just like quick, just like give it to the Lord, you know, versus you getting all upset with them. Like, Lord, you know them. You know how to teach them about that. And entrusting people to their master and learning to see their Savior over them as well. Different ones, you know, Becky and I's family is getting to know each other more and like learning how to trust God together, praying for family members and like, Lord, you know this person, you know the things that they're struggling with, and we're agreeing with your love over them and the blood of Jesus over their life. And learning how to really intercede, you know, going from a place of trying to fix people to actually being channels for God for people. And so anyway, God's desire is for Him to have His expression through us. And praise God that He has made a way through the cross. Look to the cross of Jesus, because that is God's view of that person. For God so loved the world that He gave His only Son. He doesn't love the system. He doesn't love what they're doing. Sin is still sin in God's eyes. It's not like God loving people means sin doesn't matter anymore, right? But that it's actually dealt with at the cross. That is where it's dealt with. And that's where I have to deal with it for me. But here's the thing. That's where I have to deal with it for other people too. I have to be able to see that for them as well. Otherwise, I will be receiving God to be my Savior and merciful to me, but I'll be saying, well, He's not their Savior and He's not merciful to them, right? And I want to have God take it easy on me, but I want him to be hard on them. No, oh Lord, you know, get my attention. So anyway, I just wanted to, no, this is a little unconventional here, but does anyone have any feedback? Does anyone want to share any comments or anything that, is there anything that the Lord's putting on anyone's heart here to chime into what's been said so far on anything? Mr. David, yes, sir.
We've seen so many things going on in the United States, around the world. It seems like there's a lot of anger. Seems like people are very, very upset. People seem to be unhappy with their lives. People seem to be unsatisfied with the way things are, way they're being treated. But if they kept their eye on Jesus and what he'd done for them, I think it would all be gone. All that anger would be gone. But I think you're right. I think people have missed the step where they take it to the Lord, or they don't know that that's a thing they're supposed to do. So it's on us to tell people that they have an advocate. Sure, he's a judge, he's our Savior, but he's an advocate in heaven for us. And I think if people knew that there was an advocate, if they weren't trusting in the world, but trusting in God, I think it would make a big difference.
Amen. Amen. Mr. Maurice.
Well, first of all, I think that you and Becky did a really good job with the analogy and how you put that together. That was really some great information. I just wanted to add to that. For me, sometimes I have to keep it really simple. And if there's anybody out there like me, the one thing that I must remember, God shows me how much that he has forgiven me for. And I am the chief sinner, as has been said by others in the Bible. So if I just, I have to remember, man, I can't be judging anybody, and I can't have any unforgiveness for anybody, because Jesus said, if you do not forgive, you will not be forgiven. And that's one thing that I cling to remember, that I must forgive. And I do damn myself for those resentments. And I ask God to take it away from me, and I pray for the people that I have resentments towards, because I don't want to miss out on the blessings because my heart wasn't right. But thank you for that message. It was there. It was good.
Yeah, amen. And we got to keep our eyes on the Lord and on his kingdom. And I just want to, this is a simple encouragement. I want to encourage all of you guys, spend time with Jesus. Because if you're just being yanked around by the media, you're listening to the wrong source. I mean, you can glance at that and find out what's going on, but you need to be looking at Jesus Christ, okay? Because otherwise, see, the world doesn't have an out. The system is stuck. The only out is when God opens your eyes, oh my goodness, the kingdom, the cross, I can actually legitimately deal with hurt in my life, and it's not by taking it out on someone else. And praise God, there is a Savior. There is a Lord. There is an answer. And God is beyond the world system. His kingdom is true. And thank you for those of you who shared too. And Lord, we just ask that you would continue to give us light, open our eyes more to you, keep our attention on you, Lord, that we would be able to respond under your authority in situations. Lord, thank you that you are speaking. Lord, you are drawing hearts, and that we get to be channels for you in situations. Lord, ministers and priests and advocates, agreeing with God, agreeing with our Lord. I just pray, Lord, that we would hear, look to you, and not just look to you for ourselves, but look to you for those around us, and begin to agree with you for the people around us, Lord. I just thank you so much for your speaking here. And if there's anyone here, Lord, who doesn't know you, I pray, Father, you'd open their heart, soften their heart to receive that there is true forgiveness and healing in the blood of Jesus and in what he did for us at the cross. Thank you for it, Lord. Amen. All right. Yeah, I can come up.
Thank you. Going to offer an opportunity for people to come forward. For prayer, if you want to come forward for prayer. Maybe you've been wrong. Maybe you need to repent. Maybe you have a need. For which you need prayer. Sorry, I have all these buttons. Anyway, we're just going to sing this song, Come Holy Spirit, and just allow the Lord to minister to you.
Strength and your power.
Looking at the word to see what I might bring to you today for the communion, and I came across this passage in John chapter 17. So we know that John chapter 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 all deal with Jesus at the Last Supper with his disciples in the upper room. And he has this long discourse where he talks to them, and in chapter 17, he prays for them. Scholars refer to chapter 17, John chapter 17, as Jesus' high priestly prayer. And he is our high priest, that we are taught that. So here we are, and we get a little bit of a glimpse of what is happening in that room way back then, because John writes it down for us. It was so important that he remembered it, he memorized it, the Holy Spirit brought it to his memory and allowed him to give it not only for the people of his time, the people of his day, but for us. And those early disciples who followed the apostles took that teaching and they passed it on and they preserved it and they kept it for us. So it's very, very interesting here in John chapter 17. He says, beginning in verse 20, I do not pray for these, meaning those who were in the upper room with him. I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word, that they may all be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that you sent me. And the glory which you gave me, I have given them, that they may be one just as we are one, I in them and you in me, and they, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that you have sent me and have loved them as in the same way that you have loved me. That passage of Jesus' prayer, that part of his prayer, just absolutely astounds me when he says that he wants us, those who believe through the testimony of the apostles, to be one in the same way that he and God the Father are one. One in nature, one in spirit, one in fellowship. He wants us to be one just like that. Isn't it sad that we have division? We have division in the church. We have Protestants and Catholics. Isn't it sad that we have division in the church? There's Presbyterians and Baptists and Methodists and Episcopalians and all these different divisions in the church. You got black churches and white churches, Hispanic churches and Chinese or Korean or whatever kind of churches. Brothers and sisters in heaven, there's one church, the Church of Jesus Christ. The word church, ecclesia, means those who called out, those who are called out. Called out of darkness into his marvelous light. Called out of the world system into the kingdom of God. That's where our unity comes. We're not all the same. God doesn't want us to be cookie cutters, you know, all made exactly the same. We're all different. I heard Tom Hendricks preached over at Rio Vista last week. He was really, it was a great word. He said, you know, God made men out of the dust of the ground. And he breathed in him and they made a life-giving spirit. He says, you know, if you look at the world, if you go out there in nature and you look in the Grand Canyon or the Badlands or you look in some place, you see there's all kinds of dirt. There's black dirt and red dirt and yellow dirt and white dirt, tan dirt and brown dirt. And why is it that one pile of dirt thinks it's any better than any other pile of dirt? We're all just vessels of the Holy Spirit. We're all just vessels of the life of God in us. Not because our pile of dirt is so great, but because of his choice and his calling and his welcoming us. Hallelujah. So brothers and sisters, we're going to share together in a remembrance of the Lord Jesus. And on the night that he was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it and divided it and gave it to all his followers there who were with him. And he said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in memory of me. And also in like manner, he took the cup. And when he had blessed it and he gave it to them, he said, take it all of you. And the interesting thing is that Paul in his explication of the Lord's Supper in 1 Corinthians 11 says, for as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Brothers and sisters, we are one. We are equal before the cross. We are equal before the Lord. And we have a Savior who is their master, and they have a Savior who is our master, and we all stand before him. So we're going to come, and there's plates here with bread and juicers, like cups are stacked on top of each other. So you take a double cup, and if you pull out the juice cup, in there is a little piece of wafer, which we're going to share, and there's the bread cup. And when you get it, just take it back to your pew, and we'll share the bread and the juice together in a symbol of our unity. And as you come forward, we're going to sing a song. If you want to sing a song, that's fine. If you don't want to sing a song, it's okay. But let your mind be open to what the Lord would say to you, and let it be on the Lord and on nothing else. So, Father in heaven, thank you for the body of Christ. Thank you that there's all different kinds, all different shapes, all different colors, nationalities. Lord, there's all different personalities. Thank you that we are one before you. All of our dirt, Lord, you have made beautiful. You have made alive. You have a purpose for it. And when we see it in great contrast to one another, when we see it for who we are and for what you have called us to do, it's so that, Lord, everybody would realize that the gospel is for everybody. It's not just for a few select. It was one of the early heresies of the church, that the gospel was only for a certain privileged few. Oh God, thank you that Jesus is no respecter of persons, but that he calls all, that there his desire is that none should perish, but all should come to eternal life. Lord, as we remember you, would you unite our hearts, would you unite our lives in one purpose, to serve you and to live out the gospel, to share the good news with others who don't know. And Lord, as people come forward, they have the opportunity to put an offering in the plate. Lord, I pray that you would take those offerings, whatever they may be, or if they don't have one, that's okay too, Lord. But you would use what is given in faith into your kingdom to build it up and to grow it, Lord, that there wouldn't be none in the world who have not experienced or seen the love of God in us and who have not heard the word of God through which faith comes. Bless this time, we pray now. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit.
For the power of
This is the body of Christ, which is given for you. And this is the blood of Christ, which was shed for the forgiveness of your sins. Drink it, all of you, in memory of him.
I have the announcements. Okay, so, well, I guess the biggest announcement that I have is that we have another beautiful nephew. His name is Ezekiel St. John. He was born last Sunday night, and it was a rough birth, and they thought multiple times that they would have to do a C-section, but we were praying, and everybody who was praying, it really, really helped. And he came out perfectly, and there's nothing wrong with him, and he's beautiful. And Sarah's doing great, so that's amazing. Also, it's Miss Sherman's birthday was actually last week as well, so we wanted to say happy birthday to her. You have a twin now. So happy birthday. And then Miss Sullivan's birthday is on the 19th as well. So.
Happy birthday to you.
And you get a song.
Happy birthday, dear Kathy. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday to you.
And Miss Sullivan's birthday is on the 19th. So we have to sing happy birthday to her too, if she's watching virtually. So happy birthday, Miss Irene.
Happy birthday to you.
And then also, for all the small groups that are happening, the Thursday night group and our Friday night group, they're all on Zoom. All the information to join the Zoom calls are in the bulletin, so please look at those if you would like to be a part of that. Also, we June 22nd to the 27th, our family is doing a virtual Journey to the Heart retreat. So this is the same curriculum that Tim and Becky take to the prisons in North Florida when they go on those retreats. And our family has done it for the past year. Last year we did one at our house, and it was just really, really incredible. Just a time to get real with yourself and real with God on deep, deep issues that you don't even think you have. So we're also going to be doing that by Zoom as well, and information for that is in the bulletin, or if you have any questions about it, ask my mom right there. It's going to be the 22nd to the 20, yeah, Monday through Thursday in the evenings, and then Friday, Saturday all day. So yeah, so just so you know, for the Zoom times, it'll be that. And it is really incredible. I've done it before, and it's real, people. It will take it down. You can come live. You can. If you're healthy, you can come to our house. But if you're not, watch it on the computer. If you don't know, don't come. Watch it on the computer. That's all I have. And we're still gonna continue church like this. If we have any updates, obviously we'll go on our website. You can also give your offerings through the website. If you don't bring anything physically, you can do that as well. But yeah, if you have any questions or need anything, you can email Paula or check the website for any updates.
Lord, we just thank you for a good word today, Father. We thank you that you are the judge and we are not. We make bad judges, Father. And Lord, I know that well. Lord, without love in people's lives, there is no blessing, Lord. You bless us richly and you're in our lives and you're pure love, Father God. We thank you, Lord, that you care for us so much. You care for all of us. You care for the whole world. You say in your word, you don't want anyone to perish, but all to come to know your Son, Jesus Christ. So we pray the blood of Jesus over the whole world today, Lord. We know we're in turmoil everywhere in every corner of this earth, Lord. We know who's behind that. So, Father God, help us, Lord, to love those who seem unlovable. And, Lord, help us to just reach out and care for people. Lord, we just thank you, Lord, for the message today. We thank you for each other. As we go, keep us safe, and Lord, protect us from all evil. Surround us with a hedge of protection, Lord. You know, we're surrounded by a lot of evil, but we're surrounded by you too. So, Father God, we thank you for that, and we thank you for your love in our lives. In Jesus' holy name, amen. Amen.
One more song. You're free to stay, or you can be dismissed as you wish.
The God of the impossible. He's the God who can do anything. He allows himself to do. The mountains move, the seas divide, to show that he is on my side. I know that his promises are true. God who can do miracles.